What is deliverance? Let's discuss that subject. What exactly is deliverance? The Bible is full of texts that talk about deliverance from the Old Testament, the Gospels, the Epistles, and even in the book of Revelation. So, what exactly is deliverance? Let me give us a foundation and then I will give you my definition. Now, the first thing I want you to know about deliverance, please look up before you write, is that generally deliverance has to do with a system of rescue, a system of freedom from maybe bondage, danger. I'm giving you the overall scope. Every time we mention the word deliverance, it has to do with a system that provides rescue, a system that provides freedom from bondage, from danger, and generally speaking, from evil. Every time we talk about deliverance, it has to do with rescue, it has to do with emancipation, it has to do with freedom from any of these three: bondage, danger, and then generally speaking, evil. Are we together? Let's look at two scriptures. Exodus chapter 6 and verse 6. Exodus chapter 6 and verse 6. I hope I'm right. It says, "Wherefore say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out." The word "bring you out" there is the word deliverance. "I will deliver you from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will lead you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments." So we see different expressions here that relate to deliverance. The Lord is saying, "I will bring you out from their burdens, I will lead you out of their bondage, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgment." Why? This is because of what happened in chapter 1 and verse 11. Let's go to chapter 1 and 11. Same Exodus, chapter 1 and verse 11. It says, "Therefore, they did set over them taskmasters." Listen carefully. The purpose of the deliverance in chapter 6 is because of a situation that we find in chapter 1. "That therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Python and Ramesses, all of the gods of Egypt." So they were subject to a system of labor, a system of bondage and a burden. What was the assignment? To build cities for other gods. Are we together? They were mandated as an act of affliction to build treasure cities where they kept the booties that they had gotten from war and from oppressing neighboring nations, and then to also build different tabernacles, places of rest for all their gods and their idols. And the Lord said that, "I will bring you deliverance." So before there is need for deliverance, there must have been a system of bondage. Are we together? That subjects men, that subjects territories, that subjects both animate and inanimate things to some sort of danger, some sort of oppression, and so on and so forth. Are we together? Let's look at Colossians chapter 1. Paul is teaching the church in Colossae. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14. Then I would like to teach something very briefly here before we move on. It says, "Who hath delivered us," talking about Jesus now, "who hath delivered us from the power of darkness." Everybody say, "power of darkness." Notice the Bible didn't just say he delivered us from darkness. He delivered us from the power of darkness. That means darkness is powerful. Darkness is a force. It is very unwise to believe that all of these spiritual forces are not powerful. We only say they are powerless relative to the superiority of God's intelligence and the power that is now in motion through the Christ. Are we together? When you are contrasting darkness relative to the excellency of God's power, his all-surpassing victory, then it is valid to consider Satan and all his cohorts as powerless. But relative to the spiritual advantage, the plane from which these spirits operate, it is very childish and immature to believe that they do not wield any kind of power and force on their own. Even a normal human being who can access the realm of the spirit, any dimension higher than the three-dimensional realm, has an advantage over one who does not sustain that ability. Are we together now? I have taught you that any dimension you can access outside of the three-dimensional realm will provide you an advantage over the natural person. Scientists would tell us that even lower animals that we call lower have the ability to perceive danger and perceive reality that the normal man who is unrefined, are we together, cannot perceive. Is that true? We see dogs, we see animals respond to people. Some of them have very superior sense organs. These are beings that are not empowered by any kind of spirit whatsoever, yet they wield an advantage. So it is I'm just buttressing on this to help us understand, because you see, one of the greatest challenges with the body of Christ is we just copy everything we know. We never take out time to allow the spirit of revelation to break down the truths that have been passed down from generation to generation. Just because we read it in a book and a senior man of God advocated it, or certain people that represent pillars to the body, most of them had the understanding. But most of us just receive it as head knowledge, and we teach it in Bible schools. So most believers just have the chaff of that knowledge. There is no substance that backs up their conviction. Are we together? So darkness is powerful. Paul is not ashamed to tell us. In fact, here's how Jesus said it. He said, "Behold, I give you power." Are we together? That's Luke 10:19. Can we just run there and then return back to Colossians? Luke chapter 10 and verse 19. "Behold, I give you power." Listen, the word power there is not the Greek word dunamis. It's the word exousia. It's the word authority, right? It's an authorization to legislate rather than the ability to by yourself cause change. Are we together? "Behold, I give you exousia," authority, "to tread upon serpents and upon scorpions, and over" how many? "All the power." Jesus himself is acknowledging that the enemy has power, but that he has given you an ability to manifest and legislate above that power. And then he says, "Nothing shall by any means hurt you." The only reason why nothing shall hurt you is because you are operating from a dimension that is higher than the existing. That means if something is hurting you, it means you are not accessing and working with that power, or you do not have knowledge on how to put it to work. Are we together now? God bless you. So back to Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13. I hope we are together. "Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness," and then the Bible says, "hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear son." 14. "In whom we have redemption through the blood, even the forgiveness of sins." So he's telling us the basis for that translation, that the possibility to be translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear son has happened on the basis of redemption, and that by the blood. Are we together now? So salvation is a form of deliverance. The salvation that has been given believers today that we enjoy, the Bible does not just call it redemption alone. The Bible calls it deliverance. What then is deliverance? Write this down. I did my best to scrabble an intelligent definition that will capture everything that I believe the word of God says about deliverance. So let's try and see if my definition makes sense. Ready? Deliverance is a system for experientially establishing the victory and the authority of Christ or Jesus Christ. Don't worry, take it gradually. I will repeat myself. Deliverance is a system for experientially establishing the victory and the authority of Jesus Christ. I'm going to continue. I'm just breaking so that you write. Let's take it again. Deliverance is a system for experientially, underline the word experientially, establishing the victory and authority of Jesus Christ. Can I continue? Over Satan, comma, demons, and all the powers of darkness concerning our lives. A system for experientially establishing the victory and authority of Jesus Christ over Satan, demons, and all the powers of darkness. Over Satan, demons, and all the powers of darkness concerning our lives. By this definition, we see that deliverance for a believer and the scriptural approach to deliverance is much more than the activity of physical exertion, like a present-day fight. Deliverance is concerned with establishing, making a reality that has been finished to become your experience here and now. Are we together? So that deliverance is a system for experientially establishing the victory and authority of Christ Jesus over Satan, demons, and all the powers of darkness concerning our lives. I wrote something small here, that deliverance and then by extension spiritual warfare for the believer in Christ today is about establishing and manifesting victory rather than fighting for it. Listen carefully. Our approach to the subject of deliverance and spiritual warfare has to do with establishing and manifesting victory rather than fighting to create it. It's important that you have this understanding. And this revelation alone will make all the difference in your approach to the subject of deliverance and the subject of spiritual warfare. That you and I should approach the subject of deliverance from a perspective that seeks to establish and manifest the victory that is already wrought through the substitutionary sacrifice of Christ, rather than an attempt to physically exert energy to fight and win as though it was a product of your own exertion. I think this in itself, I can dwell all night explaining this, because this may be the reason why many well-meaning individuals and by extension deliverance ministries get little or no victory out of the abundance of the physical exertions. Many of us here may be victims of that experience. So we're not talking about a state here where you fight for victory in terms of physically confronting Satan one-on-one, as it were. I will tell you where that revelation came from. Are we blessed? So say after me, deliverance for the believer has to do with establishing and manifesting authority over darkness rather than fighting for it. Are you getting the point now? Let me dramatize something here. Please come, doctor. Come. Watch this. You stand here and hold my book. This is your inheritance. This is your possession. Please look up. I want to dramatize something that will help us. You stand here. And then, they are all ladies. Where are the gentlemen? Sam, come. Now, watch this. The Bible says, and you have to understand, this is where I think many people find confusion. When the Bible speaks, look at this very carefully. God speaks from the standpoint of eternity. He does not speak as if he's talking within the frame of time. Are we together? So in the speakings of God, he always speaks with the expression of completion, which is not a lie. But then the dynamics of converting the prophetic realities that have been finished in Christ to now become the experience of the saints is where there is confusion. Are we together? So the Bible tells us from the foundation of the earth, the Lamb was slain, but there are still people going to hell today. Are we together? If the Lord is to talk to you now, if you were to see Jesus, Jesus will look at you and tell you should not be crying financially because you are walking in abundance. That's how he talks. But then you will think that he's being rude and sarcastic to you, because at the point he's talking to you, you may not even have 5 naira. He cannot speak otherwise. His viewpoint spans, he's not dimensional in his approach. If he breaks himself to be dimensional, it's an act of his mercy to help man understand him. Are we together? That's why he's called Alpha Omega. The word "and there" was just an expression to help us comprehend. He is both the beginning and the end. So to him, there is nothing like beginning and end. In his dimension, that does not exist. Are you getting my point now? So God can speak to you and say, Emeka, finish the house by tomorrow, whereas you don't even have land. That's God speaking. Emeka, finish the house by tomorrow. And as at the time he's talking, your landlord is waiting with a policeman in front of you, and God will never talk about the landlord. Emeka, I have given you your house and your key. You will even see it in a vision, God giving you key, and you say thank you, and then wake up from the vision with a rude knock from the door by an angry landlord. Now, how do I reconcile what I have seen? Because God will not change. He speaks once. It is only you that hears twice. The first hearing is the hearing of the flesh. The second hearing is now the hearing of the spirit that brings understanding. Once have I spoken, but you need to hear twice, because the first hearing is from a carnal point. But then the Holy Spirit now helps you to have the ear that the Bible says, he that hath an ear, the second kind of ear, you now hear from the spirit, the hearing that brings understanding. That's why the Bible says faith comes by hearing. But there is a superior hearing. Hearing now, not just by your senses, by the word of God. Are you understanding what I'm teaching you now? So this guy is now confused. And he's saying, in the realm of the spirit, the Lord spoke to me and said, I have given you abundance, yet nothing is happening. And then the Lord appears to you, and you are trying to say, oh Lord, look at all the demons and the witches. And then the Lord tells you something like, my grace is sufficient, or my victory is still in force. And you wake up and you are like, oh God, how can you be speaking like this? Whereas in experience, that's what Paul was trying to teach the church in Hebrew. He was quoting from Psalm 5. What is man that thou art mindful of? Not the son of man that thou visitest him. The Bible says you have made him lower than Elohim. Are we together? You have crowned him with glory and honor. You have set him above the works of your hands. And that in doing that, you did not leave anything under his feet. But he creates a dimension. He said, but as it is today, we do not yet see. Experience. So you must be able to balance between the prophetic communications of the spirit, the prophetic communications of the word, and the experiential manifestation of the same in your life. Otherwise, you will die like a chicken quoting the word of God. Between the prophetic speakings of God and the manifestation in your life, there is a mystery that connects them. And those who have this are the ones who become possessors. It is your possession in Christ. But it takes an understanding of what to do to make it your possession here. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled. Where? It never said in your life. Thy word is settled in heaven. It will take engaging these mysteries to make the word settled in your life. Ah, your help has come. This is already a deliverance for someone. Because for many years you kept jumping. Oh my God, I see victory. Jesus said it is finished. Everything is all right. Wonderful. Amazing. My life is full of beauty and glory. You are not lying. But after 10 years, 15 years, your father said this thing, and while he was saying it, sickness was eating him up till he died. I don't want you to feel bad. I'm not trying to be sarcastic. Are we together? You said this yourself, and after 10 years, there's nothing in your life that demonstrates the victory of Christ. And some, out of that frustration, will just say, this is a lie. No, it's not a lie. Forever your word is settled. But to know how to make it our experience, one of the mysteries that have been allocated by the wisdom of God to make spiritual realities that are established in the Christ to manifest in our life is called the mystery of deliverance. Are you getting the point now? It is not the only kingdom mystery. I've taught you many of them. We're approaching one of them. Now, this gentleman wants to possess his possession. This is a son of Jacob. He's read Obadiah chapter 1 and verse 17. He's believed. Are we together now? Because the Bible says, whoever believes our reports, the arm of the Lord will be made manifest in his life. Now, this brother believes. But every time, standing between him and that inheritance, just turn to face me, Sam, is an obstacle. This brother has read in the Bible that we have been translated. Colossians 1, 13. It didn't say we will be. The Bible says we have been. But he's seen something that is a curse in his life. Watch this. This guy knows the word of God. I hope you understand that. He has believed. He's a worker in church. And he has seen that every time people get to the edge of breakthrough, something happens. Now he said, in the name of Jesus, I don't believe this. I am exempted. And to his shock, regardless of that confession, his life is still a victim of it. That thing happens as if the thing didn't hear him. Are you getting what I'm saying now? Please listen very carefully. Okay, this guy comes from a family where everybody is barren. I'm sorry for this. Are we together? Everyone is barren. And now he makes up his mind. No, it is God that makes everyone a fruitful. I mean, he can make the wilderness to be fruitful. You know, children are a heritage from the Lord. Now he has confessed that he has done that well. And it is true. But in experience, now he gets married. And to his shock, he finds out that his wife cannot get pregnant. And he says, no, the devil is just joking. Let me just release my faith and you watch what happens. 1 month becomes 1 year, becomes 2 years, becomes decades, becomes 20 years. And the man is angry by 75. And he's no longer believing in Jesus. And when you come to him as a zealous young man, war giant from Koinonia, man of God, since I was blind, say, if you don't get out of here, I will slap you. I spent 60 years forcing the word to work. My conclusion is that God, alongside all the scammers called preachers, are liars. Some of us, that person I just described, may be your father, may be your mother. They will show you pictures of them and Reinhard Bonnke when he was young and tell you, I and tear it in your presence and say, I don't believe all that junk again. The frustration that comes. You come from a family that is full of poverty and goodness. You found the truth and you are happy. You are rejoicing over it. And all of a sudden you find out that you are now a graduate and your elder sisters are looking at you and say, we graduated 15 years ago. None of us, the highest among us, just got a contract job for 1 week and it was over. And you come and say, it's because, you know how arrogant we are, young people, when we are just touching revelation. We mock at others and laugh and say, oh sisters, it's because of the church you are going to. Me, I'm going to Koinonia. Wait and see what happens. Then you are a graduate and you celebrate the first Christmas as a graduate with no job. It touches you and you pretend, no, I think God is working something powerful. After you dance and sing and do what you know to do, by 5 years, you now sit with them in a discussion and you are like, so this thing is true. This is why my mother was not happy. This is why my father was not happy. This series is saving you, many of you. Many of you are already going through what I'm saying now. And if you don't open your eyes and your ears to listen to the way out, you will be very frustrated. How about men of God, like our sister shared, who come from terrible families with idol worship, and then they get born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and begin to walk in strange miracles and start a ministry and say, oh God, God forbid, I mean, I used to be from a family of idol worship, now I'm free. And the guy begins his ministry. After 5 years, he finds out that the members go down, everything goes down, an attack comes on him and the ministry, and he goes to tell his uncle, and the uncle laughs and say, why do you think I stopped being a pastor? Because I was once a pastor. Were you told? He said, no. So, well, let me educate you. I was once a pastor. The crusade that happened in this city, I was the chairman, organizing committee. The same thing that happened. You would try to argue and say, uncle, my own is not like your own. He said, it's the same thing. It's there. And then many of you now, just like I was, stand and you are confused. You say, no, let me go back to the Bible. And you still see it there. And hath translated us from the kingdom of darkness. And hath translated us, not will translate. And hath translated us. Many of you rush and come to us, men of God, and say, sir, I read here and hath translated me. I believed everything you said. Why is my life like this? Listen to what we tell you. You don't have faith, or you really don't believe it. Look at me, I'm rich, I'm entering a jeep. So he said, I'm okay. Money can deceive. To think just because you have a jeep and you have a nice watch, you are free. No, there are many other dimensions. You don't have to be delivered to be rich. There are many people under yokes of darkness that are millionaires. So be careful lest you use money. The reason is because money has a very funny way of making your needs met. So it can lie to you to think just because you don't see any obvious need yet, you are free. We have used money for a long time in the body to mean that I am free. And say, what's the proof? Look at my estate. Look at 5 cars. Look at a flourishing church. Does that look like someone under oppression?
Ebenezer, 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 my helpers, Ebenezer.
Reading volumes of books, I went to almost every bookstore I could find and gathered books and read books to prepare myself. On fire, I was seeing the power of God move through my life. I was having encounters, and then to my greatest shock, in the midst of that spiritual height, demons come to me. Regardless, I started quoting scriptures from secondary school. You would receive awards. There were 52 scriptures. If you could quote, they would give you an award. I don't know how many times I got that award. And you would think, how then should I hide the word in my heart? To quote 52 scriptures every year, new ones. I'm not talking of old ones. I could quote chapters of the Bible. And here comes demons into my room. And I'm shouting in Jesus' name, the blood of Jesus. And they are not moving. I'm saying in the name of Jesus, I'm a child of God, and they are not moving. Who will I tell this? Who will believe me? God, have you suddenly become weak? Listen, when you see me just stand to talk and demons are crying, find out what happened. I want to show you where the problem is. These demons will press my neck. The anointing didn't leave me. The anointing is still there. The same way Elisha died of sickness with the healing anointing still in his bones. Why didn't the anointing work while he was deteriorating to death? Yet the anointing raised a dead body who didn't have faith. The dead body was not begging, please raise me. Just it came in contact with bones. Couldn't the anointing bring back flesh like Ezekiel 37? Because we know it's a possibility. So why didn't the anointing bring back the prophet again? There are mysteries in this kingdom. What you do not know, you can argue to your detriment. It will smash you into pieces, like it's happening to many people. We are just not honest to confront truth until we find light. For me, I pray that God will make you like me. I don't hear yes, sir. I keep searching until the truth is found. Many of you, you see, when the Holy Spirit refuses to allow an answer satisfy you, it's because there is a grace in that area He wants you to reveal to the body. So you come to a man of God, you come to me or anybody, and we just give you explanations to manage our ego. And the Holy Spirit will say, no, no, with all honor, that's not the answer. He's telling you, find out so that you can help someone. If I didn't pass through what I passed through now, I probably will wave this teaching like many are waving and say, look, let's just focus on Jesus. And you are focusing on Jesus, but you are seeing that something is wrong. Everything the Word of God declares is true. It is the system for accessing it we do not know. And what we have been taught is not wrong, but is largely incomplete. This series is to give you the balance. You hear testimonies of people already. Look at the pastors with their churches. Look at the gentlemen that came. Someone from US just gets up. Another person just sends 4.5. You think the person doesn't have relatives in need? Doesn't he have brothers and sisters who are looking for 30,000? And he can't help them. And then come somewhere. I told you, just follow me. By now, this brother is frustrated. Oh God, give me my possession. And he comes and he says, man of God, I'm still waiting. And I said, don't worry. Abraham waited 25 years. What are you complaining about? You're a small boy. Come on, just be paid. And I start getting angry. You are getting rude. You are challenging my anointing. My anointing is angry with you. I will curse you. You see that? And the brother leaves me quietly and goes back. And he knows something is wrong. I'm not being sarcastic. I love the body. Listen carefully. There must be an answer to this. That answer is what will bring about the experience of possessing your possession. That even the critic in your life will know that the hand of God, this brother has caught this. This sister has caught this. I prayed to God and I told God, I said, by the time, Lord, we finish this series, let us hear of testimonies that people will stand up and say, no, this is, if not because the person sharing it is there, we will think it's a lie or stage manage. I told you last week, you can know that deliverance has happened to a person and a family by the speed. That's when you know that those realities have been piled up in the spirit for many years, and it's usually an avalanche. Overnight, doors, liftings, all kinds of things happen. Do you believe that a woman who should have had 6 children and has been barren for 6 years or for 10 years or 20 years, you think it's one child that will come at once? Right. By the time God shifts that barrier, you will be surprised. The kind of testimonies that will surprise you. You believe that a man that has been grounded by witchcraft for decades, the only testimony he will get is a new job that gives him 30,000. When will he recover? No, that's not the kind of testimony that follows deliverance. The kind of testimony that follows deliverance is a sign and a wonder. God makes a statement that I can, in delivering you, restore the years, the canker worm, the palmer worm. You should be married 20 years ago, but then I move and give you triplets, 2 times, 6 children at once. But upon Mount Zion, there shall be deliverance, whatever it is. And when that happens, the sons of Jacob shall possess their possession. Hallelujah. So this brother is standing. Then he takes an aggressive step. Watch this. And then his eyes is open in the spirit. Watch this. And he sees a spirit appear to him. and tell him you will never make it. But the Bible says, behold, I give you power. So Satan, where did you even get the audacity to show up in my room? Remember, your room is anointed. Remember, there's a bottle of anointing oil in that room. Don't forget. Remember, there's a communion set in that room. Are you getting what I'm saying? Remember, while the demon is talking to you, a Bible is on your bed. Have you forgotten? Sometimes a worship song is even playing, yet he shows up, no invitation, he didn't knock the door, and talks nonsense to you, and all of a sudden he leaves. Who will I tell this to? I can't tell Apostle, because I will keep quiet. And that's how many of us have been keeping quiet. As a man of God, you finish preaching in a crusade and go back in the night, and a spirit comes to molest you, to even sleep with you. You get up in the morning, who will I tell this embarrassing thing? And while you are sitting, someone comes for counseling. Counseling number one, man of God, there is a demon that comes to sleep with me every night. You almost want to run away, because that's your own experience too. It will shock you that you will lay hands on the person and he will start manifesting and be free. And you just wave the person and then return back and say, my God, now, oh God, who will deliver me? Hallelujah. Please go and sit down, guys. Let's talk now. Why does it look like there is an extreme difficulty for the saints to make manifest the realities? Remember, the Bible says, he that did not spare his son. Are we Bible students? That he that did not spare his son, but offered him up for us, will he not with him freely, mark the word freely, give us how many things? Then the Bible says that they that have received the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, what is their heritage? They shall reign. Yet we do not see this thing happening. That means something is wrong. So deliverance is one of the mysteries that was allocated by the wisdom. Remember, the Bible says that it should be made to principalities and powers, the manifold, not one fold, manifold, the multifaceted wisdom of God. Deliverance is one of the expressions of the multifaceted wisdom of God. So deliverance is concerned with experientially establishing and manifesting the victory and authority that we have in the Christ, rather than physically fighting for it. Let me tell you where this fighting mentality came from. And of course, the Bible says we should fight the fight of faith and all of that, but I mean this kind of fight. Have you seen people go to sleep and they tell you, I fought and this, and in a dream you saw yourself fighting, the victory was almost there. Are we together? Then somebody woke you get up with anger and annoyance and say, I was about to stab the last snake and you woke me. What kind of you are a wicked person. Watch this. And then you go back to sleep again, and sometimes the battle continues. It is because of the way spiritual things act themselves that we have believed that just because in a dream or in a vision, are we together? Some of you even wake up from that encounter feeling physically exerted. So because of that scenario of acting, we now believe that warfare is about physically trying to fabricate victory, regardless of what you see or the way the expressions come in the spirit. The word of God remains true that Christ has won the victory. Are you with me now? That's where the confusion comes from. And especially for those who walk very strongly in the prophetic ministry, They have helped in no way to amplify this confusion, because what you see, if not balanced with mental transformation and a good word base, you will confuse people. I can stand right now, Emeka stand, and look at doctor in a vision, and in that vision I can be seeing him inside a pit. Are we together? And now I say, doctor, you are in a pit. It's not a lie, but that is just a prophetic symbolism to mean bondage. Are we together? By the time I engage in whatever mystery, the victory may show as him coming out from the pit. So over many years of seeing different scenarios, I may now write a book, or I may now propose a theology. Are we together? Where people now start physically fighting to manifest their victory. And this is why Satan reigns over us, because he's a master of the sense realm. He knows that what you can see will challenge you. Let me ask you a question. What happened to you last week with your night prayer? Are you not shocked at the level of attack that amplified? You see that it happened for many of us, right? I told you it will happen, because Satan is the master of the sense realm. You wake up in the night and sleep and go back, and the same experience of them oppressing you supposedly happens again. Some of you, as soon as you finish, you went back. In fact, for some of you, that activity has been on break since you became unserious with God. But now that you just started a little prayer, all of a sudden it came. Now let me tell you, Satan will use your senses and tell you the word of God claims this. If God were so powerful, where is it? Then you will now dance to the realm of the senses and say, Kai, that means let me go back to sleep. In Jesus' name, I must go back for the battle to come. You are already defeated. There's no possibility of victory under that condition. In this kingdom, the only instrument, listen carefully, the saints don't fight. Our warfare is the warfare of taking advantage of the forces of the spirit allocated to us. The force of the word, the force of the blood, the name of Jesus, and all of these mysteries. Listen very carefully, to enforce. I repeat, enforce. If the purpose of your engaging those things is to create a physical fight, you are defeated already. The devil will eat you up and spit you. Watch this. Jesus is standing, having walked on water to come. Peter says, if it be thou, listen carefully now, bid me come. And Jesus says, come. Peter gets up and started walking on water. Are we together? Now, do you think while Peter was walking on the water stopped being boisterous? It still continued. But it's just that because his focus was on Jesus. Are we together? That connection. So the power that kept him on that water was not in his legs. It was on the gaze of Jesus. Are we together now? The moment Peter didn't stop walking on water, he only shifted his gaze to somewhere else and his legs started going down. For as long as his gaze was on Jesus, whatever the storm did, now he's looking at Jesus, did not suddenly make the water quiet. It was still boisterous, but he was surprised that the water was not moving him. The element for the victory was his connection with the eyes of Jesus, not his ability to walk well. For as long as his legs remained, but he turned his attention, the Bible says he saw. That's what Satan wants you to see. Satan is a master over the sense realm. If he can deviate your focus to make you see the bulkiness of the challenges, he will bring your faith down and strike you in a way that